So, it seems that you all enjoyed my last video, all about textures. So I thought I'd look at 5 more that you may come across within your watercolour paintings. Of course, if you missed the first 10, you may be interested though in those as well. So I'll tell you what I'll do, I'll pop a link in the description down below so you can take a look at them after you've watched this video. Hi, my name is Paul Hopkinson, I'm a wildlife artist and I teach online not just how to paint wildlife but also botanical subjects as well, all in realistic watercolour detail. In this video I'm going to introduce you to 5 more watercolour textures. I'll show you how I use and paint the texture within an actual painting and of course I'll share some of my tips and tricks of getting each one to look realistic as well. I'm still looking for more ideas on the sorts of textures that you may be interested in painting, so do let me know in the comments down below and I may include them in my next textures video, as I'm sure I'll be making another video for you to watch here on YouTube. Anyway, let's start with the first texture, and this one is sand. Now there are many ways of painting sand, there really is. Now in this painting I painted a suggestion of sand but wanted the focus really to be on the shell. Now sand of course is one of those essential elements of any beach painting, so let's see how we paint it. You find that sand is made up of many different particles but gives kind of an overall effect of being all in one colour. However, there's a lot of colours behind the scenes when you really zoom into that reference photograph and look really deep into the colours that you can see. But to create this sort of look, you can use a splattering technique, one of my favourite techniques actually, and both with paint and masking fluid as well. Now try to get slightly different sizes and colour sand particles by flicking different ways. So I tend to go from the side of the paper and that can kind of skim across the paper as you do so. Sand varies a lot from beach to beach, we know that. So this is quite a pale grey sand actually. But other beaches are more yellow and also more pebbly and more rocky in some places as well. We can also work the same technique on top of a base layer as well. So perhaps put an initial wash over the entire sand area of raw umber or raw sienna. Allow this to dry and then start to work the splattering technique over the base layer of paint. So when you're working on sand, you can use a lot of stippling techniques with a single brush. You can add slightly larger marks within there, just to vary it really more than anything. So adding like a little pebble or a little stone in there will also add to the effect. And then finally removing the masking fluid so I can paint the shell for this main painting will complete the sand area. Now we can start on the shell. Our second texture is snow. Now this can give any painting a lovely wintry feel. So as it's a bit like sand, so snow is essentially looks white, I know that, but when you start to paint it you realise there are actually quite a lot of other colours involved as well, so like behind the scenes. So there can be reflected colour from objects around on the snow, especially the sky, because you get a lot of blue in the sky, especially on a bright blue kind of winter's day, and that will reflect down onto that snow as well and kind of replicate the colours within the snow. And there are certainly colours behind the white that really create the depth and the three-dimensional feel to the snow itself. Now these behind the scenes colours tend to be things like blue, purples, greys, so quite cold and cool colours. Well, it is kind of snow after all. So whilst they look intense and as you apply them they can actually look a lot lighter once they have dried. Now I like to add white over the top by stippling really, it's like a stippling effect with the tip of the brush, and that creates a feeling of snowflakes and like a textured feel to the snow, even though we know it's usually very quite fine and soft. And these will leave those underlying tones underneath to kind of create the 3D effect within the snow. So you've got to really look at the angle you're going to be working from for the light. So if you've got the light coming from, in this case, on the top left hand corner, you really want the shadows on the underside on the bottom right hand corner. But you've also got to imagine the shape within the snow. So the snow might, you know, not just be flat on the front, it might come out at the bottom a little bit in bumps and all sorts of different shapes. So imagine a variety of shapes within the snow and where the light may catch different areas of it as well. So working that effect by getting that background colour on first of all will allow you to gradually build on the top of that by using, in this case, a very old brush of mine, which I use normally for mixing my colours with. But that's because it's a stiff bristle brush and I can load that with watercolour white and very lightly stipple it over the top. And you can see the effect that you get from that as well, which I prefer. At least this way, the colours underneath still show through without completely filling in the snow effect. Remember, those colours are there underneath the scenes or behind the scenes to kind of work for you at the end of the day. From the side view camera, you can really see how the underlying tones come into their own as white is applied over the top. Don't forget to hit subscribe down below and hit that bell icon as well. Then you get notified every time something new is published here on my YouTube channel. Now this is another texture you may paint which has like a reflective colour inside it. So this is the third texture we'll look at today. So droplets are all about the reflection of light on colour and the way that it tends to sort of reflect all the surroundings around the area of the droplet, very often actually in reverse. So when you pinch into that reference photograph, make sure it's a very large one though for this, you can really pinch in and look at all the reflections. It's like a mirror effect sometimes as well. So you can actually see a shape of a tree or a picture of a tree in there or the landscape beyond it. So it's well worth doing that. So you have to remember to be able to paint these items within a droplet. So it's a bit like the eye of a bird really. So you can see the world around the droplet reflected within it. So this really is what you paint. At the same time, you need to maintain the exact shape of the droplet as well, and like a teardrop effect. But sometimes, it depends on how it is, you find that it's not just that teardrop at the end. It can be very elongated, like for example on the swan, which I'm painting now. So the spots on the face on the swan are very round as you can see here, but you got to think about the light and the dark shade. So it's going to be quite dark on the underside and then lighter obviously towards the top. Again, like we said earlier on, think about the light source and the direction the light is coming through and also those reflections that you can see within that one little tiny droplet. But at the same time, you really need to maintain the exact shape of the droplet as well. So there aren't really kind of any wobbly edges or, you know, they are quite smooth like glass really. Now, when you do add white paint over the top, and I'm using watercolor white here, but you can use white gouache, which is quite a nice one as well. Again, think about the direction the light is hitting that water droplet. And also sometimes you get like a reflective light as well behind the water droplet itself, so bear that in mind. And that could be a little bit more subdued, so you might need to very lightly just water down that white paint just a touch. When you're working on a very elongated drip, in the case of the beak on this swan, then you've got to taper those lines out and just break them up a little bit as you come down that little droplet. So you've got to remember that when you're working on it. So applying the white really sort of intensifies and creates that three-dimensional shape of the water droplet itself. So having this white on there, especially when you've got a darker or mid-tone background, works extremely well. But you must take your time, you know, because when you're starting to add the highlights on there, it's very easy, believe you me, I know, on overdoing the white paint. But as long as you take your time with this, and keep looking at that reference photograph, you see exactly what I mean by that. And again, look over those reflective lights and the overall shape of each individual water droplet that you can see. And how the light kind of reflects and bounces off that, well, that cylindrical shape. All these texture examples have been taken from complete real-time tutorials. So click on the card above to find out more about joining my online school. One thing I tend not to do is overload the brush. Remember to lower the brush with white paint, Roll it as you pull away from the mixing tray and give it a dab on some tissue before you go to the painting. Plastic. I know, plastic varies so much, it really does. So hopefully you won't come across too much of plastic within your wildlife paintings, but we very often do, especially in this case with the dog's collar. Now you can see with this dog's collar, there's a lot of detail involved in just plastic. I know, you won't think it. So when you look at my example, as with the snow and the droplets, I've really had to take into account the shiny surface and how that can sometimes pick up colours and reflect it from elsewhere. Because it depends how shiny that plastic is to begin with, doesn't it? Now the edges of the plastic are also very, very important as the surface itself, and they need to be quite defined. So even though I'm not one for outlining things, in this case with this part of the buckle on the clasp, I'll outline one kind of edge itself first of all, then the inside of that edge, I'll very lightly soften that down to one side, if you wish, of that line that I've painted. So using a damp clean brush, you go back in there again, with a damp clean brush though, keep washing it out, and then very lightly blend it out, so you've got more of a curved feel as well. When you're working with the colours and anything like this, try to maintain that rich colour that the plastic, in this case this kind of pinky red colour, is going to be. So don't try and add too much in the way of black or anything like that within that mix. You also need to look carefully at the surface of the plastic, so some will be shiny, other areas can be quite dull as well, especially if it's worn in places where the clasp in this case has been used far too many times. So in fact, the surface of the plastic can be incredibly varied, so look carefully again and zoom in at that reference photo. It's very important to consider the shadow on the shiny side of the plastic, because again, that will create that three-dimensional feel which we need to give it like a solid item, which is basically what it is, isn't it? Check out that card that's in the top right-hand corner of the screen if you'd like some fur painting tips and techniques. Don't overload that brush again, so remember not to put too much paint on your brush when you're working with anything like this, and remember to blend it out gradually. Now, before you start with any colours, especially when you're working on plastic, test out those colours first, because when watercolour dries, it can dry a completely different colour. Sometimes it really can. You know, what looks really rich and kind of nice bright red within your mixing palette can look quite, well, flat and dull on the paper. And this is because when we're working with anything like this, when you look within your palette, there's a high concentration of colour, so it's a thicker well of colour within there compared to the flat version as you lay it onto the paper, so just bear that in mind. Now when you're working on the highlights, again, think about the direction the light is hitting the plastic, so just remember that. So think how it's going to hit the edges of the plastic, but also, as I'm doing here with the white, I've not overloaded the brush again, so there's not too much paint on that brush, and then I've just lightly softened around the edges. Now if you're finding my video useful, click on that thumbs up icon down below. The single second of your time can help more people see my video and enable my little channel to grow even more. Now our last texture will be a bit of a thorny subject. I know I've got a cracker joke every now and then. So we're going to look at the thorns on a dog rose stem. Now as with the plastic and the droplets, we're looking at something smooth, but the thorn has grown and as such has formed in a particular way, so very, very spiky as you can see, but also quite solid. So we're going to paint the thorn in the direction it has grown to build the subtle tone and differences to give the round but sharp feel to the piece. But within something so small, it's so tempting to paint it all in one colour. But you can see from this example that there's a huge range of blended colours within it, from yellows to purples to blues, and even, as you can see in there, even a little bit of black in the corner, which I use in this, so don't tell anybody, okay? So the colours on there are going to be quite vibrant to begin with, but once again, as those colours dry, they'll dry a little bit paler, which is normally the case of watercolours. And it all depends, obviously, on the consistency of the paint and the amount of pigment you got within your mix. So once again, we're really looking at very smooth edges, and the effect that we get from shadows on a curved object kind of means it uses both dark and light, because you need light, you need dark. One can't work, obviously, without the other. So these can be achieved simply by increasing the number of layers that we apply to certain sections as opposed to others. So when you look at this one, I'm actually painting quite a few layers on this one thorn. But when you look more towards the tip of the thorn, you find there are fewer layers because I want it to remain paler and brighter in colour. But I'm also considering the overall shape as well whilst I'm doing this. So you've got to think about the direction of the brush strokes, because the direction of the brush strokes for items like this tend to go in line with the thorn. Now when you start working on all them fine details, start switching to your fine detail brush. In this case I'm using a size 00 brush, so very tiny, very small, but it's perfect for working all these fine details. Using the lifting off technique works really well, again, to kind of create highlights within the thorn. And I'm doing that by wetting the brush, just wetting it first of all, taking a little bit of the water off the brush by dragging it over some kitchen roll, and then just lifting off a little bit of paint at the same time. So you can do it that way around to create extra highlights within any subject that you paint in watercolour. And the effects will all depend on the paint that you use, because some paints can be staining as well. I'll slip a card to the top right for more information on painting botanical subjects. Now, white again is used to really intensify the highlights on the edges of the thorns, again where the light is catching it. So I've got to think about the direction of the light again. In this case, the light's coming from the top right, not the top left as before. Okay, so bear that in mind. So when you highlight something like this, you've got to think about, well, it's not just like a straight line. You've got to break up the marks as you do so. Well, take your time when you work with watercolour white and always think less is best. You can always add more later when you come back to it with fresh eyes. Now, are there any other textures that you would like to see me paint? Or are there any that you'd like to see more detail on? So let me know in the comments down below. All these paintings are available in my online school as completed tutorials. So click on Learn More to find out about becoming a member. I'll see you in the next video to the right, which goes through 10 more textures on how to paint them.